Good morning. We have general questions. Question one, James Kelly.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government what progress it is making in the payment of the living wage in public contracts.
Cabinet Secretary Rosanna Cunningham.
Our recently announced programme for government sets out our clear commitment to a range of measures to expand the living wage in Scotland, including through public contracts. We've increased the funding of the Poverty Alliance to promote take-up of the Living Wage Accreditation Scheme, and we will work with them to explore models to boost public and third sector uptake of living wage. We will host a living wage accreditation summit with business leaders, and the Fair Work Convention will prioritise the role of the living wage in their work to develop a fair work framework for Scotland. In addition to paying the living wage to those covered by our public sector pay, including those in the NHS, the staff of contractors working in our buildings will also get the living wage, as demonstrated through our catering and cleaning contracts. We will publish statutory guidance for public bodies on how workforce-related matters, including living wage, should be taken into account in public contracts, and we will implement provisions in the Procurement Reform Scotland Act 2014, which will require public bodies' procurement strategies to make a statement of their general policy on payment of a living wage. And, Presiding Officer, could I take this opportunity to congratulate the Scottish Parliament for the recent announcement in respect of the living wage extended to contractors here in this building.
James Kelly.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer, and I also congratulate the Scottish Parliament on payment of the living wage to all workers and contractors. The Cabinet Secretary will be aware that the First Minister recently announced that agreement had been reached with Mitie to ensure that all cleaners at Scottish Government locations would be paid the living wage. Can I clarify that I am aware that Mitie have a contract with Anne Easland College in Glasgow, and can I clarify there that the announcement from the First Minister covers all cleaners from payments made through the Scottish Government, including those in the education sector and specifically at Anne Easland College?
Cabinet Secretary.
James Kelly is asking about contracts which are not within the direct purview of this government. We will want to encourage all of those contracts also to be living wage, but at the moment the deal with Mitie is in respect of those who are working directly for and within Scottish Government confines. If the member wishes to raise specific contracts with me, I am aware that Mitie do contract in the higher and further education sectors, and there will probably be some attention to be paid to that and a job of work to be done there. But the recent announcement is in respect of those who are directly paid through the cleaning contract to the NHS.
Question two, Chick Brodie.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what action it can take to improve customer awareness of the dangers of rogue traders in the construction industry.
Cabinet Secretary Keith Brown.
There are a great many reputable traders in the construction industry in Scotland, and there is a range of support to help people to find and use them. The Scottish Government encourages homeowners to use traders who are members of trade associations. Trustmark is a government-backed initiative to help consumers find reliable and trustworthy local tradesmen to carry out repairs inside and outside the home. In addition, which local authority trusted trader schemes, the Federation of Master Builders, Find a Builder Service and the Construction Licensing Executives Reference Service are all to be commended for helping homeowners to find reputable traders. Advice is also available direct from local authority, private sector housing teams and trading standards officers.
Chick Brodie.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for his answer. While consumer education is a devolved matter, consumer protection is reserved to Westminster. Will the Cabinet Secretary pursue with his counterpart at Westminster the devolution of consumer protection so that in Scotland newly qualified, registered and appropriately named tradespeople like electricians, plumbers and roofers can carry out such designated work and so avoid heartache for households penalised by misrepresentation by those purporting to be so qualified?
Cabinet Secretary.
Further devolution of consumer protection powers will enable the Scottish Government to create an effective, efficient and fair consumer protection regime that's focused on the needs of Scottish consumers and businesses. We welcome the new powers of advocacy and advice recommended by the Smith Commission, but it's currently unclear whether or not power over redress is to be devolved and will therefore be seeking clarification from the UK Government. Both the UK and Scottish Government should start preparing in good faith for the transfer of the powers identified in Lord Smith's report. For our part, the Scottish Government will use whatever new powers are delivered to the Scottish Parliament to ensure we take forward this Government's work to create a fairer and more prosperous country for everyone who lives here.
Question 3, Sarah Boyack.
To ask the Scottish Government what action it takes to support local authorities in meeting demand for home care provision.
Minister Jamie Hepburn.
Last year, the then Cabinet Secretary for Health and Wellbeing commissioned the Residential Care Task Force to look at the way we commission and deliver services for our most vulnerable people living in care homes. The report of the task force was published earlier this year, containing a number of recommendations, not least to improve the commissioning and provision of those services. The Scottish Government accepts in principle the recommendations, and we are currently working with COSLA, Scottish Care and other partners to take forward its recommendations for the long-term transformation of residential care in Scotland.
Sarah Boyack.
Minister, NHS Lothian accounts for more than 1 in 5 Scottish bed days lost to delayed discharge, with older patients particularly affected. In Edinburgh, £8 million is being invested in a new 60-bed care home at Royston, increasing capacity to around 600 residential spaces, and the Council is increasing funds for reablement. However, health and social care is 25% of the total service expenditure, and the Council has to find savings of £142 million over the next 3 years. So to balance the books, they're increasing care charges, or looking at that certainly for this year's budget, and looking at moving to reduce the use of agency staff. Is there action the Scottish Government can take now to address the underfunding of our local authorities to allow them to deliver the greater capacity we need in social care services now?
Minister.
Well, let me be clear to Ms Boyack and to the Chamber. This Scottish Government is already taking action to tackle the issues around delayed discharge. In August, we made £5 million of targeted funding available to 7 NHS boards to help alleviate immediate pressures in the system due to delayed discharges. We have also allocated an additional £5 million to all partnerships in November, and this is leveraging in other funding from health boards and local authorities. And of course, we have jointly with COSLA established a discharge task force to oversee and agree priority actions to improve discharge from hospital. And in relation to Lothian, specifically in reference to the funding that I have mentioned, Presiding Officer, the Lothian Partnership received £712,000 from this pot. I believe that Edinburgh City and NHS Lothian plan to use some of this funding to reopen Pentland Hills care home to provide intermediate care, step up, step down care that will enable people to return home following hospital admission, and where possible provide an alternative to admission to hospital. So action is happening. We need to see more of this kind of service being delivered, and where many other areas are doing just that.
Question 4, Claire Baker.
To ask the Scottish Government when it last met NHS Fife and what issues were discussed.
Cabinet Secretary Shona Robertson.
I met the Chair and Chief Executive of NHS Fife yesterday, along with the Leader and Chief Executive of Fife Council, to discuss how to tackle the issue of delayed discharge in Fife.
Claire Baker.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response. I'm sure that following yesterday's meeting, the Cabinet Secretary will be well aware of the pressures that are facing NHS Fife and Fife Council. We've seen a doubling of locum costs, a reduction in the number of beds and nursing shortages. And last week it was revealed that bed blocking was leading to over 11,000 bed days being lost in Fife. Almost three quarters of those were people aged over 75 who were waiting for care arrangements to be made. I appreciate the Cabinet Secretary will go into detail about the steps she'll take to try and address this issue, but funding does remain at the heart of this. It's been reported in today's Courier that the NHS Fife and Fife Council have identified a £3 million funding gap which they're working together to address. How can the Scottish Government help to address this?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I say to the member that the meeting yesterday was very positive and constructive? We discussed a clear and agreed plan between the Council and the Health Board that they are now implementing to tackle the issue. Their plans include the discharge of up to 60 patients before Christmas and the joint funding of the Council and Health Board to continue with that plan for the rest of this financial year. We also agreed with NHS Fife and Fife Council that they would continue to work with the Scottish Government on service and funding transition to make sure that they take maximum benefit from the plans for integration, which will take place from April of next year. The member will be aware, of course, that an additional £836,000 has been allocated since August to NHS Fife to address the issues related to delayed discharge. But I want to reiterate, as I did yesterday, that this is my top priority in taking forward resolving this issue. We are putting in some short-term measures, but without a doubt, it is restructuring and shifting the balance of care that is going to lead to a sustainable change in the way we deliver services into the future.
Question 5, Bob Doris.
To ask the Scottish Government what action it is taking to improve access to rail services for disabled people.
Minister Derek Mackay.
The Scottish Government continues to support substantial improvements to railway stations, trains and the provision of dedicated assistance for disabled passengers provided by ScotRail. For example, Scottish ministers have prioritised 22 station upgrades through the £41 million Access for All Fund, which has included the creation of step-free access at several stations across Glasgow.
Bob Doris.
The Minister for that answer. Gilshill Station in the Cadder area is notoriously poor for disabled access. In fact, it's virtually impossible. I have met and corresponded with ScotRail a number of times about this issue, and they say that it does not qualify under Access for All criteria. I wonder if the Minister could look specifically at the barriers with his officials in relation to Gilshill Station, and can he tell me what other funding streams might be available, or whether he would consider extending the Access for All criteria? Because right now my constituents, whether disabled or mothers with prams, can't access rail facilities in Cawdor.
Minister.
Well, certainly it's the Department for Transport that sets the criteria that guides how we give priority for Scottish stations to be included in Access for All, and that is the fund that's dedicated to address access issues at railway stations. And I suppose in those terms they don't meet the criteria, as Mr Doris has mentioned, but I'm happy to provide further information on additional support that can be given for access to train stations and the future meetings I'll have in relation to disability access and equality on transport services, and look again at how we may be able to support this particular station. But essentially the criteria set by the Department for Transport on the fund dedicated for this issue.
Patricia Ferguson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As far back as 2009, Transport Scotland were indicating to me that Gilshill Station would not be considered because of its relatively, and I use the word advisedly, low passenger usage. It was numbered at that time as number 199 out of 343. But if that is the only criteria that can be used, I think the Scottish Government would be well advised to consider taking up with the Department of Transport whether there can be an adjustment to that, because stations like Gilshill will never be able to qualify for that kind of assistance. Mr Doris is absolutely right. It is a very difficult station for people to negotiate, and mothers with buggies, of course, do not have access to the assisted passenger reservation service that is fortunately available for those with a disability. And I wonder if those are discussions that the Minister would be interested in taking up.
Minister.
Of course, I'm happy to pursue the issue, because we have every sympathy with those who seek the most local access to their train station. There is an equality issue here as well. The latest information I have is that the station is the 214th busiest in Scotland of the 351 stations, with 98,900 passenger journeys recorded in 2013. But I would want to highlight the opportunity provided by ScotRail that does provide alternative transport free of charge to the nearest accessible station for any disabled passenger who cannot use that station due to lack of access. But of course, I'm happy to engage with the Department of Transport in terms of the criteria they use to guide us and the funds that are available.
Question 6, Bill Kidd.
Presiding Officer, thank you. And to ask the Scottish Government what sanctions there are on developers that make significant changes to the insides or outsides of listed buildings without applying for listed building consent.
Cabinet Secretary Fiona Hislop.
It is an offence to make changes which affect the character of a listed building, be that internally or externally, without listed building consent. Planning authorities can refer cases to the Procurator Fiscal with a view to prosecution. As an alternative or in addition to seeking prosecution, the planning authority can issue a listed building enforcement notice requiring rectification of the damage done. The view of Scottish Ministers is that prosecution for unauthorised works is best confined to cases where the works done are so radical that rectification is not practically feasible. There is a range of possible actions available. In many cases, the issue may be resolved through the submission of a retrospective application for listed building consent, but in some cases the best way to achieve practical improvement to the building's condition is for the planning authority to issue an enforcement notice.
Bill Kidd.
I thank the Minister for her comprehensive reply. Can the Minister elaborate in any way on what action local authorities and indeed, more importantly, neighbouring residents affected by such works can take to ensure that the affected buildings, such as Kelvin Court in my constituency, is returned to as much as possible its original state?
Secretary.
Well, clearly the Planning Authority, Glasgow City Council, have the key responsibility here, but of course any neighbouring residents or any person that are concerned about alterations being made to a listed building without appropriate consent can take action by reporting their concerns to the local planning authority, in this case Glasgow City Council. There are a range of possible actions, but obviously rectification is the best possible without prosecution, and I would encourage anybody who has got concerns to raise those with Glasgow City Council.
Question 7, Hans Al-Malik.
Thank you and good morning, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it is developing strategy guidance for minimum standards for temporary accommodation, and if so, when will it be published?
Minister Margaret Burgess.
The Scottish Government currently has no plans of developing more statutory guidance on temporary accommodation. We have recently strengthened the unsuitable accommodation order in relation to households with children and pregnant women in temporary accommodation.
Hans Al-Malik.
I'm sorry, that's quite a disappointing response. I refer to the Minister's response to my question last week on temporary accommodation. And last week, when the Minister stated that the vast majority of temporary accommodation is of good quality and well-managed local authority accommodation. However, a significant number of people are in poor quality and unsuitable temporary accommodation for long periods of time. For example, on 30th of June this year, 73 households with dependent children were living in bed and breakfast and hotel accommodation. Will the Minister once again take up my invitation to visit some homes where families, a family in one bedroom, are living in poor accommodation, just to give her the reality of how people are actually genuinely suffering? I believe this is not only a responsibility, but it's a moral duty to do so.
Minister.
I think it is important to restate that the vast majority of children living in temporary accommodation will be in good quality and well-managed social housing and not unsuitable bed and breakfast accommodation, and they'll be waiting to be moved into settled accommodation. But of course, none of us want to see anyone living in accommodation that doesn't meet their needs and is not suitable for their needs. And the housing regulator, if there's issues with any particular accommodation, then we certainly want to know about it, and that can be raised with the regulator, who will inspect the temporary accommodation that people are living in. But I would say the Homelessness Prevention and Strategy Group has and will consider any evidence in this regard to see if anything more is required. We are clear in the importance of ensuring good standards are met as part of this, and Scottish local authorities have been surveyed to identify a reasonable standard and cost for temporary accommodation. And this has certainly informed the approach of local authorities. And I'm more than willing to speak with the member and the issues that he raised. And if necessary, I will not shy away from visiting accommodation that's not suitable. So I'm not shying away from that. But what I am saying is that the regulator will have to know about these issues before we can resolve them.
Question 8, Lord Campbell.
To ask the Scottish Government when it last met the UK Government to discuss the future of RAF Lucas.
Cabinet Secretary Keith Brown.
The Scottish Government maintained direct contact with the UK Government on their plans for RAF Lucas throughout the period of the military basing review. Following the announcement in 2013 that the UK Government was to withdraw the RAF from Lucas and convert the base into an army barracks, the Scottish Government receives updates on the implementation of those plans through the firm base arrangements, which involve regular meetings with both the Ministry of Defence and military contacts.
Lord Campbell.
The Minister will be aware that the Department for Transport recently closed its consultation on a UK spaceport in which Lucas was identified as a potential feasible location. Can you advise if any discussions have taken place with the UK Government in relation to that matter, as well as the potential for a feasibility study into whether the base could host a civilian airport?
Cabinet Secretary.
I'm able to confirm that Scottish Government officials received a briefing from the UK Government on their spaceport consultation prior to its announcement in July. The Scottish Government wants to see the spaceport located in Scotland, and at this stage we remain neutral in terms of the six potential Scottish locations. The Scottish Government and its agencies have offered to provide advice and support to any of the Scottish airfields that want to pursue the spaceport opportunity. It is, however, for the owner of each airfield to determine if they wish to do so, and of course in the case of RAF Lucas, that is the Ministry of Defence.
Thank you. We now move to First Minister's questions. Question number one.